Jim.
Thanks, Bill. I want to try to offer both a chronological and a geographical context for the American case. American historians, particularly my friend and colleague David Kennedy, are much exercised by the notion of American exceptionalism. And I think, indeed, the problems that we do face are exceptional, but to understand that, we have to look for a minute at the rest of the world. And I want to frame my remarks with a famous article that was written by the American political scientist Harold Laswell in 1937, which was entitled "The Civilian Versus the Garrison State." Garrison states, for Laswell, were states in which the specialists in violence, especially the military, played a predominant role. Civilian states were states in which businessmen, specialists in what Laswell called bargaining, were the ones who established the priorities for institutions. This was an old debate in European social and political thought about the direction of modern societies. And it looked in 1937, and even more in 1941, when Laswell republished this article, that the specialists in violence were winning virtually everywhere. That garrison states, driven by the imperatives of the Great War, were being established throughout the world. Well, in fact, after the Second World War was over, it seems to me that slowly, gradually, but inexorably, the balance tipped toward the civilians, particularly in that part of the world which had for centuries been the center of military activity with global consequences, and that was, of course, Europe. Beginning in the 1960s, the specialists in violence, the military, were marginalized in virtually every Western European state. Military budgets shrank. The number of soldiers conscripted decreased, and although conscription remained, it became a less and less effective way of raising military forces, something which nobody seemed particularly worried about. In the years after the 1960s and 70s, these civilian values and civilian institutions spread out of Europe, first into the periphery of Europe, into places like Spain and Portugal and Greece, and then after 1989 into Eastern Europe, which with the end of the Soviet Union, Eastern European states took on these civilian values and institutions. It looked, and if you look at the European case and elsewhere in the world as well, including a place like Japan, it looks very much as though the civilian values, the values of bargaining, of commerce, of Pacific activities, that these are the ones that predominate. There are, to be sure, still garrison states. North Korea seems to me a kind of archetypical garrison state. And there are others as well. But there's a good reason to think that although they're still dangerous to themselves, dangerous to their own population, dangerous to their neighbors, that they are increasingly isolated in the global scene. And that then raises the question, what about the United States? Now, one of the reasons why Laswell's argument has had such a long shelf life, and it still is one of the most influential articles, I think, of the 20th century, is because Americans have traditionally feared the shadow of a garrison state. This was, after all, the substance of Dwight Eisenhower's famous farewell address about the military-industrial complex. And there is a shelf of books published in the last few years that talk about the new militarism, the new way in which Americans are in danger of falling victim to this garrison mentality. Andrew Bashevich at Boston University is, I think, the most eloquent and insistent advocate of this position. And then there is, after all, some considerable evidence to back up these kinds of anxieties. The United States, while it spends a relatively small amount of its budget, if you compare it, let's say, to the Europeans, or indeed if you compare it to most of the rest of the world, it is still a substantial investment in military institutions. The United States has an archipelago of bases. It has a fleet which is able to project power on a global scale. No other country matches this in its extent, its ambitions, its aspirations. And yet it seems to me the specter of a garrison state is not something that we ought to worry about. And one strong evidence for that, I think, is the relatively small degree of concern for military matters, indeed for war, in the American public. The remarkable thing about the 10-year war we've been fighting in the Middle East is how little political resonance it had. Where are the Iraq War movies? Where are the protests for and against? And those of us who grew up in the Vietnam era are again and again struck by the sharp contrast between the way this war, now more than a decade old, has had so little impact on American political culture. And the reason for this brings us directly back to the subject of the Daedalus volume and today's panel. The reason why the war has had such little resonance is that for most Americans, it hasn't cost anything. The army is small. The army is becoming, and one of the interesting sets of data in this Pew survey that David talked about, is the degree to which the army is becoming more and more an army like the British army, an army of families, an army in which soldiers are apt to have parents who are soldiers, fathers, but increasingly both fathers and mothers, who have siblings that are soldiers. In other words, the army is becoming not only smaller, not only less a part of Americans' experience, but also more and more insulated. And you can see that this paradoxical case of a military of great power, great extent, great effectiveness, that is increasingly disconnected from what is essentially a civilian society. The exceptional, to go back to Laswell's terms, the exceptionalism of the American case is that the United States is a civilian society that wants to have a powerful military that wants to be able, rightly in my judgment, by the way, but that wants to be able to project global power. And that takes us really to the sets of questions that animate this volume and which I think ought to concern all of us. These are questions about the impact on the military itself of making enormous sacrifices for a society that is, in many ways, not terribly engaged with them, and that does not, they feel, understand them. The questions for all of us, the deep moral and political problems that a democracy has in imposing a burden on a relatively small, disconnected sector of the population. These are political problems. They're institutional problems, their moral problems, and they are, it seems to me, problems that have no easy solution, but that ought to be very much part of our political struggle to understand.